The last class we have seen, or up to, where Vivekananda goes on a wandering, that is, as a sannyasin. It was the character of every sannyasin to take a trip through to know more about the lives of others. So in that we see himself also taking a tour through India to learn more about the situation, the plight of the people, and that's what he was trying to do. So first in 1888 he took the first wandering trip, and then in 1891 that was to fulfill the great destiny. So first from a curiosity of the sannyasin to learn little more about, but by 1891 he had already a vision what was his going to be a world mission for him. So in one of his wanderings at Porbandar, he arrived after visiting Verwal and Somnath. He stayed for 11 months and helped the Diwan of the place, Pandit Shankar Pandurang, in translating the Vedas. He completed his study of Mahabhashya and learned French at the insistence of the Diwan, who suggested to him to go to the West, where his ideas were likely to be better appreciated. Hearing about the parliament on religions to be held at Chicago, he expressed to his host at Porbandar his desire to attend it. The Swami found himself the guest of Maharaj of Mysore, Chamaraj Wodeyar. In his talk with the Maharaj, he unburdened the heavy load he was carrying, as though carrying on his head, and expressed his intention of going to the West to get funds to alleviate the material condition of India. The Maharaj offered to bear the expenses. So we see here Vivekananda taking the tour. Two tours he made through the width and breadth of India, and he learned more about what was happening to Indians and the abject poverty and the utter illiteracy of theirs and in his condition. And there he knew that if ever he wanted to help the poor, first he had to help them out in the poverty and raise them up. Only then we'll be able to give them the lofty ideals about the religion and the salvation of them. The Maharaja had agreed to, or offered to bear the expenses of going to the West. While the arrangements were being made for the sailing, a sudden invitation came from Maharaj of Khetri to go to his place, with the assurance that he would do everything for the trip. The Swami agreed to this. With the Maharaja, he went to Jaipur, and from there left for Bombay alone. On the way to Bombay, he halted for a night at the house of a railway employee, one of his hosts, during his wandering days. At Mount Abu, he met the Swamis, Brahmananda and Turiyananda, to whom he said with great feeling, "I travelled all over India, but alas, it was agony to me, brothers, to see the terrible poverty of the masses, and I could not restrain my tears. It is now my firm conviction that to preach religion to them without trying to remove their poverty and suffering is futile. It is for this reason to find means for the salvation of the poor of India that I am going to America." So the intention of Swami was to find some fund to alleviate the suffering or the poverty of the Indians. So throughout his two tours through the breadth and width of India, he realized what was the main concern or main problem besieging the people of India. And he wanted to alleviate, or he told his companions, the Swamis, what he had found. That is, it is my now firm conviction that to preach religion to them without trying to remove their poverty and suffering is futile. So for that reason, he was going to America. The first session of the Parliament on World Religion was held on Monday, 11th September 1893, in the spacious hall of the Art Palace. And its huge galleries were packed with nearly 7,000 people, men and women, representing the best culture of the country. Representatives of all organized religions, Hinduism, Jainism, Buddhism, Christianity, Confucianism, Mohammedanism, and Marxism were there. And amongst them was Swami Vivekananda, who represented no particular sect. The Swami represented nothing and yet everything. There was grand procession of delegates. Cardinal Gibbons, the highest prelate of Roman Catholic Church in USA, opened the meeting with a prayer. And after that, Dr. Barrows, the chairman, introduced the delegates one by one. All of them, except the Swami Vivekananda, read prepared for the first time, and his heart was fluttering and his tongue dried up. He was so nervous that he did not speak in the morning session. He went on postponing the summons from the chair. In the end, when he could no longer put off his turn, he stepped up to the rostrum and in his mind, bowing down to Saraswati Devi, began to speak. No sooner had he addressed the assembly, sisters and brothers of America, than there was a deafening applause lasting for full 2 minutes. The audience rose as one man to express heartfelt appreciation for the warm feelings which those five simple words conveyed to them. Others addressed them in a select, the set way, but the Swami touched the deepest chord of their hearts by discarding the formality and stressing on the kinship and the humanity with such sincerity. After the applause had subsided, the Swami made a brief speech. So we can see here Swami Vivekananda's first appearance in the West, or taking part in the assembly or the Parliament on World Religions. And he represented not any particular sect, he was representing India. And then the very first address, brothers and sisters of America, that was the way he addressed. No, not the formal way. Normally when a big gathering, as a formal gathering is addressed, always people will begin with ladies and gentlemen and like that. But here he did away with all that formalities and straight from his heart he addressed, and he got a rousing welcome. The Swami, however, did not take this as a personal triumph. Although he had become famous overnight and the doors of the rich were open to him, he wept over his victory, remembering his people at home, sunk in poverty and ignorance, for whose sake he had come to America. We will be dealing with one or two speeches of Vivekananda's in the session, the Parliament. The first one, at the World's Parliament of Religions, Chicago, on 11th September 1893. That is the first one. Sisters and brothers of America, It fills my heart with joy unspeakable to rise in response to the warm and cordial welcome which you have given us. I thank you in the name of the most ancient order of monks in the world. I thank you in the name of the mother of religions. I thank you in the name of millions and millions of Hindu people of all classes and sects. My thanks also to some of the speakers on this platform who, referring to the delegates from Orient, have told you that these men from far off nations may well claim the honor of being to different lands the idea of toleration. I am proud to belong to a religion which has taught the world both tolerance and universal acceptance. We believe not only in the universal toleration, but we accept all religions as true. I am proud to belong to a nation which has sheltered the persecuted and the refugees of all religions and nations of the earth. I am proud to tell you that we have gathered in our bosom the purest remnant of the Israelites who came to the southern India and took refuge with us in the very year in which their holy temple was shattered to pieces by Roman tyranny. I am proud to belong to the religion which has sheltered and is still fostering the remnant of a grand Zoroastrian nation. I will quote to you, brethren, a few lines from a hymn which I remember to have repeated from my earliest boyhood, which is every day repeated by millions of human beings. As the different streams having their sources in different places, all mingle their water in the sea. Sources in different tendencies, various though they appear, crooked or straight, all lead to thee. The present convention, which is one of the most august assemblies ever held, is in itself a vindication, a declaration to the world of wonderful doctrine preached by in the Gita. Whoever comes to me through whatsoever form, I reach him. All men are struggling through paths which in the end lead to me. Sectarianism, bigotry, and its horrible descendant, fanaticism, have long possessed this beautiful earth. They have filled the earth with violence, drenched it often and often with human blood, destroyed civilization, and sent whole nations to despair. Had it not been for these horrible demons, human society would be far more advanced than it is now. But their time is come, and I fervently hope that the bell that tolled this morning in honor of this convention may be the death knell of all fanaticism, of all persecutions with the sword or with the pen, and of all uncharitable feelings between persons wending their way to the same goal. That was the first speech, the short speech which he gave, although he was feeling so embarrassed and not able to address such a huge crowd. The moment he got onto the podium, then he was all free and he spoke in clear terms what India stood for. So he went representing India and he stood for what he was convinced of. The second speech, that is about in 15th September 1893. So why we go through these speeches, it is just to get a glimpse of the person of Vivekananda, his caliber, his acumen, and the conviction which he had grown with. In the 15th September 1893 speech, he speaks why we disagree. I will tell you a little story. You have heard the eloquent speaker who had just finished to say, "Let us cease from abusing each other," and he was very sorry that there should be always so much violence. But I think I should tell you a story which would illustrate the cause of this variance. A frog lived in a well. It had lived there for a long time. It was born there and brought up there. And yet was a little small frog. Of course, the evolutionists were not there then to tell us whether the frog lost its eyes or not. But for our story's sake, we must take it for granted that it had its eyes and that it every day cleansed the water of all the worms and bacilli that lived in it with an energy that would do credit to our modern bacteriologists. In this way, it went on and became a little sleek and fat. Well, one day, another frog that lived in the sea came and fell into the well. "Where are you from?" "I am from the sea." "The sea? How big is that? Is it as big as my well?" And he took one leap from one side of the well to the other. "My friend," said the frog from the sea, "how do you compare the sea with your little well?" Then the frog took another leap and asked, "Is your sea so big?" "What nonsense you speak, to compare the sea with your well?" "Well then," said the frog of the well, "nothing can be bigger than my well. There can be nothing bigger than this. This fellow is a liar, so turn him out." So this is what Vivekananda expressed to the fact that why there is so much violence. Because each one is holding on to his religion as the ultimate or the absolute. That has been the difficulty all the while. I am a Hindu. I am sitting in my own little well and thinking that the whole world is my little well. The Christian sits in his little well and thinks that the whole world is his well. The Mohammedan sits in his little well and thinks that that is the whole world. I have to thank you, America, for the great attempt you are making to break down the barriers of this little world of ours, and hope that in future the Lord will help you may accomplish your purpose. So we get a glimpse of what Vivekananda is trying to get across, that India is a land, or India is a place, or the land which had accommodated or given refuge to practically all the religions of the world. Address in the final session, it is 27th September 1893. The World Parliament of Religions has become an accomplished fact, and the Merciful Father has helped those who labored to bring it into existence and crowned with success their most unselfish labor. My thanks to those noble souls whose large hearts and love of truth first dreamed this unfearful dream and then realized it. My thanks to the shower of liberal sentiments that has overflowed this platform. My thanks to the enlightened audience for their uniform kindness to me and for their appreciation of every thought that lends to smooth the friction of religions. A few jarring notes were heard from time to time to this harmony. My special thanks to them, for they have, by their striking contrast, made general harmony sweeter. Much has been said of the common ground of religious unity. I am not going against now to venture my own theory, but if anyone here hopes that this unity will come by the triumph of any one of the religions and the destruction of others, to him I say, brother, yours is an impossible hope. Do I wish that Christian would become Hindu? God forbid. Do I wish that the Hindu or the Buddhist would become Christian? God forbid. The seed is put on the ground, and earth and air and water are placed around it. Does the seed become the earth or the air or the water? No, it becomes a plant. It develops after the law of its own growth, assimilates the air, the earth, the water, converts them into plant substance and grows into a plant. Similar is the case with religion. The Christian is not to become Hindu or Buddhist, nor a Hindu or a Buddhist to become Christian. But each must assimilate the spirit of the others and yet preserve his individuality and grow according to his own law of growth. If the Parliament of Religions has shown anything to the world, it is this. It has proved to the world that holiness, purity, and charity are not exclusive possessions of any church in the world, and that every system has produced men and women of most exalted character. In the face of this evidence, if anybody dreams of the exclusive survival of his own religion and the destruction of others, I pity from the bottom of my heart and point out to him that upon the banner of every religion will soon be written, in spite of resistance, help and not fight. Assimilation and not destruction, harmony and peace and not dissension. So these three speeches I have taken just to give a glimpse into the very idea or the what Vivekananda stood for, or what was he convinced of, the world religion or the universal religion. It means accepting the diversity, still remaining united. That is the what is we see in the World Parliament of Religions, where he represented India and he spoke in such a way to the great admiration of all present. Now, he went to represent India. Mainly his idea was to raise some funds to alleviate the suffering of the Indians here, to find some fund. But now the whole idea has changed after his first address in the World Parliament on Religion in Chicago. Now he is called into a wider world to disseminate the spirit of the religion. So his work in America, now how he goes about doing the same, what about that, spreading the good news about the religion or his conviction. In order to further the cause of India and to free himself from obligation to his friends, he accepted the offer of a lecture bureau for a lecture tour of America. He thought that would help him also in spreading his ideas. The tour took him round the large cities in the eastern and the midwestern states. Everywhere, people flocked to hear him. His speeches, delivered extempore, were mostly devoted to the exposition of religion and philosophy as preached and practiced by the Hindus through the centuries. He also explained to the American audience, the Hindu manners, customs, and religious practices, removing some of the misconceptions spread through the monstrous and fantastic stories told by the Christian missionaries. After his appearance in the World Religion of Parliament and his speeches, he became instantly famous in America. And there were so many willing to accommodate him or keep him as a guest or do so much of favor. So many friends were there. So it was impossible for him to accept all the invitation of the friends or please them. And therefore, he found a better way when a lecture bureau of America contacted him and said that they would arrange lectures throughout America in different states. And he thought that would be the best chance for him to take. He can keep away from all the personal invitations. At the same time, he is going to get a larger audience and thus to spread his ideas. The Swami also spoke with great reverence on Christ and his teachings and the valuable contribution of the West to the culture and civilization of the world. He did not hide his admiration for tremendous progress the West had made in the fields of industry and economics, as well as for the Western democratic social systems with equal opportunity for everyone. While he was never sparing in his praise of the good side of Western civilization, the hollowness of the Western society, the tears behind the peal of laughter became more and more apparent to him as he moved from city to city. He was mercilessly critical of the defects of European culture, the signs of brutality, inhumanity, pettiness, arrogance, and ignorance of other cultures, as he was severe in his criticism of the defects of Indian social customs like untouchability and other allied evils during his lectures from Colombo to Almora after his return from the West in 1897. Thus, the Swami's Western work took him gradually beyond his original plan, which was just to raise money to uplift the Indian masses. He realized that his services could not be confined within narrow limits. He wrote to his disciples who were urging him to return to India, "I have helped you all as I could. You must now help yourselves. What country has any special claim on me? Am I a nation's slave? I do not care whether they are Hindus or Mohammedans or Christians, but those that love the Lord will always command to my service." He gave away most of his earnings through the lectures to the charitable institutions there in America, and asked his friends to do the same. He wholeheartedly devoted himself to the service of the West. So you see him quite in a different perspective now. He went with the idea to raise funds to alleviate the suffering masses in India. Now he has taken his mission in another realm, that is service in the West. And he fully dedicated to that. So his disciples in India were urging him to come back, return as fast he could, to whom he said, "I have helped you already as I could. Now you have to help yourselves. What country has any special claim on me? Am I a nation's slave? I do not care whether they are Hindus or Mohammedans or Christians, but those who love the Lord will command my service." So that's the way he found his call to the West. This attitude, however, was not a face wash. It arose from the fact that he had become conscious of the full significance of his life's work. His mission.